Grace, mercy, and peace be to you from our Lord and Saviour Jesus Christ. Amen. Our sermon text for this feast of Maundy Thursday comes from our Gospel reading from the 13th chapter of the Gospel according to St. John, verses 1 through to 17. Let us pray. Lord, sanctify us by your truth. Your word is truth. Amen. John's Gospel is interesting that on the night when Jesus was betrayed, John's account goes into much more detail, giving large sections of dialogue not included in the other Gospels. Yet on the other hand, John skips over the one event that is mentioned in the other three Gospels, the institution of the Lord's Supper. Instead, John gives for us this account of the washing of Jesus' feet. Now, the exact timing of this event is hard to determine. John 13:2 says it happens after the meal, or at least that's what the New English translations say. The older King James says, the newer translations say during the meal. The older translations, such as the King James, say after the meal. Martin Luther's German uses the word BM, meaning at or during the meal, whereas St. Jerome's Latin Vulgate uses the word facta, meaning after the meal. Thus, theologians are not agreed. There is some think that it may have taken place before the meal, as in just before they started to eat, during the supper, meaning during the whole night. Traditionally, feet washing would take place before you ate. John Charles Ryle, in his commentary, favours this position, since in verse 26, Jesus gives bread to Judas, suggesting that they have washed their feet before they've eaten. However, there is one problem with this. See, John 13:30 says that Judas left immediately after he received this morsel of bread from Jesus. But in 1 Corinthians 11:25, Paul states that Holy Communion takes place after the supper, which would mean they had first eaten and then they had Holy Communion. Which would then mean that Holy Communion would have to take place after the eating of this bread, and Judas wouldn't be present. However, Luke's Gospel makes it clear that Judas is present for Holy Communion, because he is debating with the other disciples as to who is going to be the betrayer. And this is said in Luke's Gospel to take place after Holy Communion. And so, since Judas is present for Holy Communion, and Paul said Holy Communion happens after the main meal, then this dipping of bread and feeding it to Judas in verse 26 cannot be part of the main meal, but must be something extra done after the main meal, even after the event of Holy Communion. In fact, John doesn't mention Jesus giving bread to anyone else, but only Judas at this point, as he is indicating Judas as the one who was going to betray him, though John notes that at this point the other disciples still didn't understand and thought that Jesus was only sending Judas out to go and purchase what they needed. As for the feet washing, most scholars believe that the most likely time for this event to take place is in relation to the events of Luke 22 verses 24 to 30, which happened after the institution of the Lord's Supper. Jesus institutes the Lord's Supper. The disciples then dispute about who amongst them is going to be the greatest. And then Jesus gives them a lecture as how the Gentile rulers lord their authority over others, but that this is not how it is to be with his apostles, and that they need to be servants. Since the main message of the foot washing is that Jesus has come not to be served but to serve others, it is likely that this is the most likely time when this event took place. So if we were to try and compile a chronology of Maundy Thursday night, it might go something a little like this. That Jesus and his disciples gather for the meal. Jesus mentions his betrayal and the disciples all ask, "Is it I?" Then they partake of the supper. Then after the supper, Jesus institutes Holy Communion. At this point, Jesus pronounces a woe on his betrayer and the disciples again discuss amongst themselves who the betrayer is going to be. Then a dispute breaks out amongst the disciples as to who is going to be the greatest. Jesus rebukes them and then washes their feet as an example of how they should serve others. It is after this then that we come to the events of John with verses 20 and following, in which they are reclining at table, and Peter leans over to John, who is reclining with Jesus, and asks John to ask Jesus who the betrayer is, at which point Jesus gets up, gives bread to Judas, and sends him on his way. But let us return to the main point of this story, the foot washing. Jesus comes to wash the feet of Peter, and Peter refuses. Jesus tells him that he doesn't understand what he is doing. And after this, Jesus does explain what he's doing, that he has done this as an example of service, that he, their Lord and their teacher, is willing to wash their feet, and so they should be willing to wash the feet of others. However, even this is only a part of the message, and the main message the disciples still wouldn't understand until the Feast of Pentecost. See, the significance of this act is not the foot washing, but the service. That is the main message that Christ has come to give. See, the disciples were debating amongst themselves as to who would be greatest. Jesus rebukes them, saying that the kings of the Gentiles lord their authority over them. But as his disciples, they shouldn't do this. See, the dispute of the disciples is a symptom of a deeper issue. In Acts 1, during the ascension, the disciples ask Jesus if he's then going to restore the earthly kingdom of Israel. They still didn't fully understand what Jesus was doing as the Messiah. They wanted a Messiah who would establish an earthly kingdom. And since they are his disciples, they assume that they shall be lords and noblemen and masters within his kingdom. And yet Jesus tells them that that is not what they are to do. And so he shows them that he has come not to be served as some earthly king, but to serve others. In Philippians 2, Paul tells us that Christ humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even death on the cross. Jesus came not to rule, but to die. And the disciples didn't get this. Even after Jesus gave his disciples his very body and blood in Holy Communion, telling them that he was going to shed his body and blood for their sins, they still wanted some warrior king. And so Jesus takes off his outer garments and ties a towel around his waist and washes their feet in an act of great shame and humiliation. This he does to show his disciples that he is not here to rule them, but that he is here to be stripped and crucified for their sins. And so Jesus comes to the feet of Peter, and when Peter refuses, Jesus tells him that if you refuse this, you have no fellowship with me. For when Peter was refusing this act, he was refusing it because he saw it as something unbecoming of Jesus. Jesus, you're my Lord, you're my Master, you're my King. You shouldn't be washing my feet, I should be washing your feet. You should be ruling, not serving. Peter doesn't get it. And Jesus is saying, you don't understand. If you don't let me wash your feet, you have no fellowship with me. Because the foot washing is a symbol of Christ's service for us. Christ has come to die for our sins, and if we won't let him do that, then we have no fellowship with him. See, Peter is fighting against Jesus because his stubborn old Adam doesn't want to be saved by grace, but wants to be saved by his own doing. He doesn't want God coming to serve him. He wants to serve God. Ultimately, he wants to save himself. But that's impossible. We can't save ourselves. That's the whole reason Jesus became incarnate in the first place, because we can't save ourselves. He had to come and save us. We just need to let go, sit back, and let him serve us. And when Peter hears that he needs to have fellowship with Christ, he then goes in the opposite direction, wanting himself entirely washed. Here again, Peter is now seeing the foot washing as some kind of great thing that he has to do, and that if washing his feet is good, then wash all of me. Peter is still wanting to save himself, but Jesus refuses the request, stating that the person who has already been washed doesn't need to bathe himself again. He only needs to clean his feet. And many scholars believe this statement to be referring to the fact that those who believe in Christ are saved and justified, and that we don't need to be converted again. We don't need another baptism, we just need daily contrition. Pastor Vic Fitzner of the Lutheran Church of Australia, in his Cairo commentary on John, states that once a person is washed clean through holy baptism, they do not need to be baptized again. Instead, through daily repentance, we return to our baptism, as Martin Luther taught. When we repent of our sins and confess Christ, we are not being baptized again, we are simply returning to our baptism. Because, as he says, when a person washes their feet, it reminds them of the full bath. And so, when we return to our baptism, it is a reminder of our baptism that has saved us. See, Jesus is saying that once you are saved, you are saved. And unless you have fallen away from the faith and become completely dirty, you don't need to be saved again. You just need to clean up those little bits of sin that you pick up on your daily walk. Like a person who gets out of the tub and then walks around will pick up dirt on their feet. So too, as we walk through this world, we will pick up sin in our life, and that needs to be cleansed on a daily basis. Now, this is the individual application of these words, and yet there is also a communal aspect. Because Jesus said that not all of you are clean, and John tells us that this was in reference to Judas. Yes, there is the individual application as Jesus applies it to Peter, but there is also a communal application to the body of the church. See, Jesus talks that he says, you are clean, plural. But not all of you. The you there is not you, Peter, are clean. It's you, the disciples, are clean, but not all of you. You, the body of the church, are clean, but not all of you. See, Judas is an unbeliever, but he's not a non-Christian. Today we refer to these people as Christians in name only, but the historical term for them is simply the term hypocrite. They claim to believe. They look clean, but they're not. And Jesus compares this situation then to a man with dirty feet. Most of the body is clean, but there are the dirty ones amongst them. And they are the ones in need of cleaning. Yes, every Christian is simultaneously justified and a sinner, and we do need daily contrition, but also for the church, there needs to be a cleansing of the dirty feet amongst us. And Matthew 18 tells us how we should approach this situation. We need to rebuke the fallen Christians in the hope of bringing them back through repentance. This is the washing of the feet. However, if they, like Judas, refuse to be washed, then they'll become infected. and gangrenous. And then they must be cut off through excommunication, lest their infection spreads to the rest of the body and destroys it. Now, as for Jesus, after he has washed his disciples' feet, he then informs his disciples why he did this. He did this to set an example that he is their Lord and their teacher, and that if he is willing to wash their feet, then they ought to do the same. See, foot washing is not a law, it's not a commandment, it's not a sacrament. We're not expected to have to keep this. Jesus did not command the disciples to do the foot washing in the same way that he did with the sacraments. With Holy Communion, he commanded them to do this. And with Holy Baptism, he commanded them to go forth and baptize. With the foot washing, Jesus says, you ought to do this. This is the same term used in Acts 15 in regards to eating animal blood, and in 1 Corinthians 11 in regards to the practice of head coverings. Both are good practices, and the Augsburg Confession teaches that us Lutheran churches intend to keep these practices. However, they are an ought, not a necessity. It's the difference between something you must do versus something you should do. They are best practice. And so even in 1 Timothy 5:10, when St. Paul is going through the list of being hospitable, he mentions foot washing as an act of hospitality. And so it's expected that Christians should do this. However, foot washing was not done as some pointless ritual that we just did for the sake of doing it. See, foot washing isn't simply an adiaphora, like wearing a stole or an albe. We wear these as a symbol of our office, but they are essentially pointless. You could identify the pastor by some other means. When it comes to foot washing, it's not some pointless thing that you're meant to just do just because. The actual act of foot washing was meant to be an act of service. The service is the important thing that Jesus was going on about. See, in this day and age, people don't walk around everywhere barefoot or with just basic sandals on. And so our feet aren't often as dirty as they were in Jesus' day. People these days have closed-in shoes. We drive cars everywhere. And so asking someone to take off their shoes just so you can wash their feet is not actually an act of service. It doesn't benefit them. If you were doing it, you would be doing it for your own selfish purpose of just doing the act. There are churches out there today that make this tradition of having foot washing on Maundy Thursday, but that is a pointless act. Because it is not a service to your neighbour by asking the parishioners to come up the front, take off their socks, their shoes and their socks, let the pastor wash their feet, and then have them put their shoes and socks back on and go back to their seats. That's a pointless ritual. It achieves nothing, and it is actually contrary to what Jesus was trying to do. The point of Jesus is that you should be willing to serve your neighbor even if it is difficult, even if it is something shameful. If you actually wanted to serve your neighbor in this day and age, polish their shoes or go outside and wash their car, because that would be the modern equivalent of feet washing. That would actually be something that is of service to your neighbor and is of great difficulty and maybe even shame and humility to yourself. So I urge all those pastors out there that have this foot washing practice that they should probably stop doing this. And if they actually wanted to fulfill what Jesus commands us to do in this section of the gospel, is maybe polish your neighbor's shoes or go and wash their cars. Do something that is an actual service. And so returning to the words of Jesus, It is interesting that the point that Jesus makes is twofold. It is both law and gospel. The first is gospel, that Jesus comes down to demonstrate to his disciples that he has come to serve them, to save them, that he has not come to be a conqueror but to be a servant. Here, in this act of service, Jesus brings the gospel saying, I am here to save you. And then, the next is the law, that Jesus says that since you have been served, go and do likewise. Notice the pattern here, gospel then law. Our good works cannot save us. Our serving of God does not save us. It does not achieve anything. Instead, God comes and saves us, God serves us, and then we go forth and serve not because of anything that we do, not because our serving of our neighbor is going to somehow save us. Instead, we go and serve as gratitude for what Christ has done for us and to follow the example that Christ has shown us on how to serve. We can't save ourselves by our works. Instead, we receive by grace the work of Christ, and then we go out and help others because God first helped us. We love because he first loved us. We forgive because he first forgave us. We serve because he first served us. We wash because he first washed us. Amen. And the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen.